than we could ever be. Good morning, saints of God. It's time to praise and worship Him. As we come into this house with thanksgiving in our heart, we come with joy, knowing that we serve a risen Savior. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall what? Rejoice and be glad in His presence.
Little light. 1 through 11. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus said to the disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a coat with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone said anything to you, shall you say, the Lord has need of them, and immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus had commanded them. They brought the donkey in and the colt and laid their clothes on them and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road, and others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes went before, and those who followed crying out, saying, Hosanna, son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. Matthew 21 through 11, may the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his most holy and gracious word.
Amen.
This morning, my dear Heavenly Father, we come celebrating your triumphant entry into Jerusalem. But Father, I want to stop by for a moment to say, we come to celebrate your triumphant entry into our lives.
Yes, Lord.
When you came, when we opened our hearts and said, yes, Lord, come into my life. Come into my life and save me. I pray, Heavenly Father, that the viewers watching will confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in their heart that God raised his Son from the dead. They will be saved.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, Heavenly Father, I lift up the viewers that are watching by Facebook this morning. I pray that they will accept the triumphant entry of Jesus Christ into their lives. Amen. That they will turn away from their wicked ways and say, yes, Lord, to your will and to your way. Open up their hearts and say, yes, Lord, come into my life and save me. I pray, Heavenly Father, that they will accept the triumphant entry of Jesus Christ coming into their lives, Heavenly Father. You did not come the way we wanted you to. You came the way you wanted to, Heavenly Father. Oh, Heavenly Father, I pray that someone's soul will be saved this morning. Someone will be delivered, Heavenly Father, by that triumphant entry. Heavenly Father, I lift up this service to you this morning. I lift up the speaker to you this morning. Yes. Fill his heart with your words, Heavenly Father. Oh, Master, touch him in a mighty way, Heavenly Father. Fill him up where he's torn down, Heavenly Father. And once again, I pray for those that's watching by Facebook. Touch their hearts, their soul and mind, Heavenly Father, in a special way, Heavenly Father. Turn them
that I'm still in the house. So nobody's holding you in there right now. The government said, and you can hear what the government says, that we can have up to 25%, 1/4 of what we normally have. And we're not there yet. I pray that we'll get to that 1/4. Amen. You should play your part. Say, you know what? I'm tired of wearing the same old pajamas I've been wearing to watch church. Come on, y'all. Know what I'm talking about. Amen. Amen. Sister Pastor, you can get up and say, now you pull the out the club. Call that. No. How many remember those days when you were young? Amen. Big mama, mama, whoever you were with, they said, get that clothes together. Amen. There ain't gonna be no moving around this morning. We got to get to church. Amen. So here we are. We here at our church this morning. It's good to see some folks out this morning. For those of you who are here, we thank you for coming to the service this morning. And we also thank you for those at home. But we'd like to see you come out once in a while.
That's right.
We want masks and all that, but we should do the bump out for you, talk to the masks, mumble a little bit, but we can understand each other. Amen. I really wrote this by a smile on their face, a twinkle in their eye. Amen. Somebody need to say this one another. Somebody need to hear, isn't God good? Come on, say
amen.
Good. We're here this morning. As I contemplated coming to church this morning, the old tradition we used to have, I told you about my dad when I was young. I have a tie on me, my clothes made out, all that other stuff. But I'm contemplating coming to church this morning. And I was thinking about what this service is all about. This is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday. I'm not preaching the hour, but this is Palm Sunday. And this is a Sunday you heard our people just read about how Jesus rode into Jerusalem. And because he rode in, they threw palm leaves in front of him, and they took off their cloaks and threw it before him, celebrating because a prophecy had been fulfilled. They see that the king had been, amen. They didn't understand what type of king they was talking about. He wasn't talking about a king in a chariot, but a king riding on a donkey. Amen. A king that came in, because he rode in. Because he rode in that day. One day we gonna ride in, amen. In that new city called Jerusalem, amen. So we want you to come this morning. We want you to feel those who are here to feel welcome. We want you to just praise God with us this morning. You know, God's a praise. He's great for the praises of his people. Just by being here this morning, you should give God some praise. Amen.
Yes.
Some of us got a vaccination shot. Some of us are going through that. Everything. We should just praise God for that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, I know some people are hesitant, but whoever, if God did something good in your life, come on, give me a praise this morning.
Thank you.
April 2nd, amen. We're almost to the fourth Sunday of this new year. That's a blessing.
blessing for those who see it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Can I get amen?
Amen. Amen.
Y'all don't understand what I read Mark was talking about. I went to Coolies to look for somebody. They had passed away. And we know the lady pretty well. She used to go to church with me too. She said they booked all the way through eight. The people was going on. Yes, yeah, Reverend Long said, people are leaving here. And we need to get it right on this side. Because you don't know when God can call us home. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So let's attend our service. Next week we have our service. Amen. Our Easter Sunday service. The greatest Christian holiday ever. I think those who would like to come out and join us. Our pastor will be preaching, but we're going to have a good time to celebrate the resurrection of our Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that something to celebrate?
Yep.
Amen. Come on.
Church, how many of you had a blessing this week? Can you
for you. We thank you for what you've done, but we want to thank you because you're the Savior this morning. We want to thank you, Father, for all that you're doing this morning. Oh, God, we need you this morning. Some of us need to understand that we still got hope through pandemic, through this climate, through all these changes in the world. We know one person that we have hope in, and that hope is in Jesus. I remember what my mother said, troubles will come and go, but if you need somebody to talk to, just have a little talk with Jesus, and he'll make it all right. Have somebody talk to Jesus lately. Have you had some trials and tribulation? Have you talked to Jesus about it this morning? If you talk to Jesus about it, you won't need to worry about it. Let him handle it for you. I'm glad that a person will take my cares and my troubles and say, give them to me, then leave them with me, and I'll handle it for you. Have you talked to Jesus this morning? Oh, God, we love you, Father. We give you honor, and we give you praise. Now, when you say, come on, church, hallelujah.
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 Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Sunday represent as a whole, it also should be personal. We sang a song, Sister Patsy sang a song, and she said, yes, God is real, for he has watched and made me whole. Because of Palm Sunday and because of what the Lord knew, that he was getting ready to confront. It wasn't just a day of, it was a day of celebrating, to celebrate and how he came in, but also the Lord knew the sacrifice that he was going to have to make for both myself and for you. To sacrifice for the sins of the world. So for me, Palm Sunday is so personal because that's why I stand here. God said in his word, he said, I take the foolish things to confound the wise. And though I know who I am in Christ Jesus, I understand that the only reason I am what I am is because of what the Lord done for us and the sacrifice he made. Amen. So Father God, I want to thank you for this day. I want to thank you for all the wonderful things that you've done in our life, how you have watched over us and protected us, oh God. But oh God, I want to thank you for this holy day. And I ask, Lord, as I prepare, Heavenly Father, to speak your word. According to Matthew 28, you told me, O God, and you told us to go. It was a command. So I ask, Lord, according to your word, Heavenly Father, that you remove me out of the way, and you do that in me, Father God, this day, which you call me to do. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, O God, speak, O God, to your people. Speak to me and through me, O God. And when your word go forth, let it do, Father God, in each and every one of our lives, what you, O God, purpose it to do. With nothing missing and nothing lacking in it. In the name that's above all names, that precious, that wonderful name, that name Jesus. Let us say,
amen.
Amen. A day of celebration. The King, the anointed Savior, has come. During the Holy Week, Christians recall the events leading up to Jesus' death by what crucifixion and according to their faith, his resurrection. The week includes 5 days of special significance. The first is Palm Sunday, which commemorates Jesus' humble entry on what? On a donkey into Jerusalem to observe the Passover. The entrance into Jerusalem was an active parable. It gave the faithful the sign they had been waiting for. It inaugurated the Master's final mission to his people and was a fitting prelude to the day of intense, a fitting prelude into the day of intense activity and emotion which were to fall. It focused the whole city's attention on Jesus so that wherever he went during the closing week, crowds followed him, and his name was on every tongue. And not least important, it flung down the gullet of his enemies. It defiled them. Much they could endure, but his procession through the streets was intolerable. This frantic And my supper must be put down finally. Jesus is that humiliated hour was in sowing a challenge. Every token of reward of royal honor which he accepted that day gave point to the challenge, and every hosanna of a crowd drove it home. Let the powers of evil do their worst. He knew his power. He was the Lord's anointed. He was riding to the throne which he had given, he was riding to the throne which God had so given him. I want to read today out of Mark, the 11th chapter, and you may remain seated, verses 1 through 11. In reading that, it says, when they were getting near Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, he sent ahead two of his disciples and instructed them, go into the village in front of you, and as soon as you enter it, you will find a colt tied, which has never been ridden by anyone. Unfasten it, bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Answer, the Lord has need of it. And he will send it back here presently. So they went away and found the colt tied at the door out in the open streets, and they loosed it. And some who were standing there said to them, what are you doing, untying the colt? Verse 6. And they replied, as Jesus had directed them, and they allowed them to go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their outer garments on it. And he said on it, verse 8, and many of the people spread their garments on the road, and others scattered layers of leafy branches which they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed cried out with a cry of happiness, Hosanna, be gracious and kind and propitious to him. Praise and bless is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise and bless in the name of the Lord is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna, oh save us in the highest heaven. And Jesus went into Jerusalem and entered the temple. And when he had looked around, surveying and observing everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany together with the 12 apostles. Today, I want to touch on all 11 verses, because all 11 of them, they represent so much to me. And I was looking, as I was studying, I was looking at these verses right here, and I even discussed some of it with Pastor Lee. And I looked at the power that was in all of this right here that had took place on this day right here. It was just not Jesus telling them to do something, they're getting a donkey, he's riding in, and then the people saying, Hosanna. I'm looking at everything that took place and everything that was done that caused this whole event right here. So stay right with me. It says in verses, we look at verses 1 through 3, it says, and here I put this introduction, was telling exactly, he told them exactly what to do. And now that means something to me, when we as a people of God, and that's why I said it's personal too, God told them to go and untie, to go over here and untie this donkey. Listen here, he told them to go and do this one thing. And he said, if anybody, if there's any opposition, just say the Lord has need of it. That's it. And then they went, and we look at verses 1 through 3, and it says, and when they came near to Jerusalem, or to Bethany, and Bethany, and at the Mount of Olives, he sent forth two of his disciples and said unto them, go your way into the village over against you, and as soon as you be entered into it, you shall find a colt. This is what he told him to do. He was exact. When we're on, never a man said, loose him and bring him. And if any man say unto you, why do you do this? You say, you, that the Lord had need of him. And straightway he will send him to heaven. He did exactly what God told him to do. Exactly. They did not waver from it. God said, go do this, and I want you to think and bring it here for us when we're in a situation. And God says, no matter what it was, no matter what it looked like, whatever your circumstances is, when the word of God, whatever it says, it has to come to pass. If we have a responsibility to do that exactly, not part of what he said, but exactly what the word God says. Walk by faith, not by sight. So when they went, the Bible says they went. When the Lord told them, they took off and they went. And when they went, they got there, and then what did people say? What are you doing? And then they said, the Lord has need of it. And as soon as they said the Lord, because they did not put, like we do sometimes, put our name there, but they put the Lord. They went in the authority of the name of the Lord, and they said, the Lord has need of this. And when they said it, everything stopped. It worked out just the way God told them that it was work, that it would work out, and they didn't have to deal with no oppositions. The only thing that they had to deal with, or they would have had to deal with, or we have to deal with, when we go and we go through a situation, and God says to do it this way, and we go, and we lean on our own understanding, and then we do it our way, and then things fall apart. And then we go back, and then we have to go back to the throne of grace and mercy, ask for forgiveness, and say, Lord, and then we stay in a place a lot longer than you intend us to stay in. Because when we go in the name of the Lord, and we're dealing with this situation, and we deal with it just the way God says it, it works out. Every time it has to work out. Why does it have to work out, Bobby? It has to work out because his name is at stake in it. His name, look at here. Let's look at verse 4. It says, verse 4 says, and they went their way and found the colt tied in the door, and they found the colt tied by the door without a place where two ways met. And they loose him. It says, God is not, you think about it. It says, just as the Lord said it would be, was it? Was it there just like he said it would be? When he told them, when God tells us something, when we do it, let me ask this question, when we do exactly what God tells us to do, have God ever let you down? Even though you have to deal with some oppositions along the way, has he ever let you down? Never. He has never let you down. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. But what gets us is along the way on our journey when we're trusting God, what gets us is thoughts that enter our mind. Thoughts that think about it. Thoughts that really come from the natural, but they come out of sense. Numbers 23 and 19. God is not a God that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Had he said it, and he shall not do it, or had he spoken, and he shall make it good? If God said it, it has to turn out right. Like I said, because his name is at stake. Let's look at verses 5 through 7. And a certain of them that stood there said to them, what are you doing loosing the coat? And they said unto them, even as Jesus had commanded, and they let them go. And they brought the coat to Jesus and cast their garments on him and set upon him. And he set upon it because they did it exactly the way he said it. They were now being challenged, but they stood their grounds. Life is going to challenge us sometime. Circumstance is going to challenge us. Our faith is going to challenge us. But when we, as a people, when we stand our grounds and we don't waver from that which God said in his word, I don't see how it could not work out. Even when it seems impossible in the natural, when things seem like, man, there is no way. I'll take you back to a place in the Bible. Think about a situation that we would look at today and we would know to be impossible. Abraham and his wife. Mm-hmm. We know. Now, he promised him 25 years before, but he had to wait for the promise. And through there, just think, God, you said this in your word, God. But along the way, look at everything that I've done, doesn't seem like nothing's working out. But now you get to this place, right here. And then everything is, it seems like, okay, now you're at the point to where nothing can, we know that nothing can work out. Everything's gonna fall apart. I have no money, I have no nothing, I have nothing to take care of this situation. My health is nothing to take care of this situation. My kids are nothing to take care of this situation because now, God, you said do this, but look at the place that they're in right now. Now's a hopeless place. And God in Abraham said, have you considered my wife's age? And all God said to him was, is there anything too hard for me? Is there anything too hard for me? And because Abraham, it was settled with him in his spirit, and it was settled, and because this thing is Abraham would say, yeah, I see it's too hard. It can't work out. I don't think it would have never taken place. But he didn't, and he knew. And just like us, when we're dealing with situations like that, and then we might, no, I believe, God, you can do it. I know. I don't care what it looks like. God, you said it. This is what you said. And it has to come to pass. And it will come to pass. Because his name is at stake. And I don't care what things look like. And we have to get to the place in our lives and as Christians to where, because look at how the world is going right now, to where we can believe God beyond the shadow of a doubt. We're dealing with stuff like, you think, Mr. Norman was talking about the virus and how the government shut down the church and everything. When I thought about that when I was sitting there, he can't shut down the church. The government can't shut down the church. He shut down a building. I am the church. We are the church. We can't accept that greater He that's in me than the circumstances that's in the world. He can't shut it down. But He shut down a building. He shuts down a building. The government comes. The enemy is so subtle. The government comes and He uses Corona to shut down a building and it quiet God's people. Then they decide, oh, we're going to stay home. Or we going to do this. Or we not going to, I can't go out here and minister. Dr. Scott continue to go out and minister the gospel to the people. Because why? Because Matthew 28 and Palm Sunday was leading up to all of this right here. God did not sacrifice and do this Palm Sunday and do the whole week and nobody had to sacrifice for us to happen one day. Deal with oppositions and just sit down. And then the Lord took my way here and died, people. Why? And my God is bigger than that. Man. So they can take the buildings, they can wipe the buildings out, they can burn them down, they can do all of that. But the word of God is inside of me.
Yeah.
And I am the church. Yeah. I will call out. He called me out of darkness into His wonderful light. To proclaim His gospel. And there's four gospels that He gave us. He gave us four gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But there are many books. There are many books of the gospel. What is the gospel? Good news. We are written books. The gospel. When we go out, He said, go out and greater works that you would do. I have a gospel. Sister have a gospel. You have a gospel. Pastor Lee have a gospel. And He commanded us to go out and proclaim His goodness. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. And I'm going to praise His name. We sing no song. But it's got to be more than just singing the songs in the building. We got to step out. We got to be bold. And we got to proclaim that. This day, this is what it started out. When we want to sing Hosanna in the highest, I look back and understand that day. But we ought to be saying Hosanna in the highest when we step out there. And when we're dealing with the devil putting oppositions in there. Hosanna in the highest. God is good. My God is a healer. I can do all things through Christ. My body,
yes.
He's given us something. Because God will never do like me. I will call you or do something, say this like me or you. We'll call a person or even our job to ask us to do something. And some things we can do. And then other things we can't do. We want to do, but we can't do. Or we want to be there. I told Pastor Lee. Last week, I said, I had an appointment to go to Madeira Friday morning. You know what that is. I ain't killing nobody. And so when I told him Thursday, I said, Pastor Lee, I said, I scheduled an appointment to go to Selma to a home. And so I ended up going to the other appointment because I scheduled them at the same time. And so I had to reschedule those appointments. But when God calls you on an appointment, He doesn't do like that. He don't mess up. When God says go and do it, and He calls you, when He calls you, and He gives you directions, God don't mess up in His directions nowhere. When God gives you directions, He gives you directions and say go to go and accomplish that which He sent you to do.
Yeah.
Nothing, nothing. There is no devil, no powers out there that can stop you when you're on the battlefield of the Lord. It's coming to call. He sat down. He sat down, and there was a little fire. And he stopped and put the wood or whatever he did, and put his hand, and then he got bit, and the people looked around and knew he was going to drop dead. How many of us have been in situations? And people saw our situations and we were really trusting God. And they knew our situation was going to fall apart. Her talking about you, saying, I ain't going to make it, or this ain't going to work out for them.
your good, because you love the Lord, because you are called apart to his purpose. He worked it out. Look what the Lord has done. That's why I refuse to, and Pastor Lynn knows, I refuse to say this little light of mine. I started out when I first became a believer at singing the song, This Little Light. But when I came into understanding, I know that light started out little, but the Bible says, the Word of God says, we should go from glory to glory. I don't know when a person wrote that song some years ago. I don't know what he was dealing with. And maybe at that time. But for me, I love the song. But this light, we have to go from glory to glory. And so when they see this light, they might have saw it start out little, but the light continued to grow because they continue to see what God is doing in our lives. If I be with them, I will draw all men unto myself. Let me go past my time. I'm going to look at verses 8. It says, in verses 8 through 11, I look at here where, and many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and straw them in the way. And they that went before and they that followed cried, Hosanna, blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And Jesus entered into Jerusalem and into the temple. And when he had looked around and upon all things, and now the evening tide was come, he went out into Bethany with the, he went out with the 12. And I put here, I said, their obedience caused us to celebrate. It caused a celebration and witnesses. And witness people witness the power and the triumphal entry of Jesus, the Savior, who was preparing to sacrifice himself. He was preparing to sacrifice himself for the sins of the world. He knew, though there was a celebration. But look what caused the celebration. Let's go back. Jesus told them what to do. He said, go untie this donkey. They went and they did exactly what he told them to do. Then he said, now, if you have any oppositions, just say the Lord said, you have, he has need of it. Then when they got there and they started to untie it, then the opposition was there. The people challenged them, what are you doing? I'm just talking along to you. The Lord had need of it. The opposition stopped right then. Everything stopped. The storm stopped. Peace be still. Then after that, they went and they took it. He got on it. He rode in. And because of their obedience, everybody witnessed, and it was a big celebration. There was a celebration. When God does things, but it doesn't stop right there. It doesn't stop right there because what we didn't realize is the sacrifice that he was going to make and that what he had to make. It says here, it says in Revelation 13 and 8, and all the inhabitants of the earth will fall down in adoration and pay him homage. Everyone whose name has not been recorded in the book of life, but the Lamb and the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Man, this has to mean so much to us. Because the Bible says, and I think 2 Corinthians, let me get it, it says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake, listen to this, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. In other words, God took. This is in Isaiah 53. He took my sickness. He took my pain. He took my finances. He took my family, my kids. He took everything that I can imagine. Everything that you've ever went through, I've ever went through, he had already taken it. And he took all of that, and he took his righteousness. He took what he had, because he was the perfect sacrifice. Walked the earth over 33 years, but never sinned. The perfect sacrifice that was able to come and take all our pains, our hurts, our sins, everything. And nobody had to face, even though we were celebrating over here. And he took that. But what he did, what was so important, he took his righteousness, his goodness, and he put upon all the people like me and you with that. He said, because you can't do this, Bobby. You can't die for the sins of the world. Elijah, you can't die for the sins of the world. Abraham, you can't die for the sins of the world. Because God hovered over the earth and he could not find one righteous, no, not one. And he took it all upon himself. And then they celebrated, but we really didn't know, because he even said things like, destroy this temple in 3 days, I pray. But we wouldn't get, I don't think they were getting it. And even some of us, and myself at times, don't really get it, that what he had to face and what he faced for me and you. And then he did it. And not only that, it was God that did it. He was God. And I'm thinking this. I'm dying for the sins of the world. That's enough in itself. But then you're going to have some people stand before me and spit on me and mock me and beat me and all of this and beat me like his body was beat. And I was told when they beat and whooped me with something like canine claws. What is that? That when he grabbed his skin and pulls out chunks of meat, and he's going to take that and not even open his mouth for someone like me. And I dare me or you, and he rose up, wait a minute, he rose up on the third day with all power and authority. He did, Jesus rose up. And then not only that, Colossians 2 and 15 says, and he made an open, in other words, their problem, and I'm imagining, I'm just like, sometimes I get kind of weird in here in my head, thinking about the scriptures, because I'm thinking in Colossians 2 and 15, I say, Lord, now, I can imagine you're here in this place, and then the enemy, the devil, he's celebrating all of a sudden. You rise up with all power and authority, and you make an open spectacle of him in front of all of his wealth, and you went and took everything back from him. Took it all from him. And so even his followers know he ain't all that. They know it, but that's why he come and plant seeds of doubt in our head. That's why the Bible says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on a gentleman named Tom Bernard, he writes, the crowd was clueless. They never got it right. They shouted praises. He wept. They looked for a warrior. They looked for a warrior. King riding a white stallion. They got a carpenter riding a donkey. They wanted hot. They got a healer. They wanted a prophet. They got one who fulfilled prophecy. They wanted a needy shepherd. They got a savior. They got nothing they asked for, but everything they needed.
Nah.
Only they never got it. We got to get it. They were clueless. Jesus was the only one. Jesus was the only one there who really knew what was happening. And on that first Palm Sunday, it's so easy to become like those people in Jerusalem. We think we know what's going on, but we really don't have a clue. We have a bad week, and we blame God. Our kids act out, and we blame the school. We work two jobs and wonder why things aren't better at home. Jesus comes to our town, and he wants to help. But we don't recognize him for who he is. We think he will be impressed with our boats and our businesses and our stuff. He is not. He wants our hearts. That's what Palm Sunday was all about. Jesus don't care about the rest. He wants this. He tells us. He says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. We got to understand, God is a God of perfect order. And if we think he isn't, wait till we're in this evening and look up and see the order out here. Something is holding this in its place for thousands of millions of years. It's been in its place and doesn't move, because if it was to shift things out there, was to shift a certain way, the sun, the moon, or something, what it would do. We follow this order, I guarantee you, then we will be able to say that scripture, Romans 8:28, with all boldness, with all confidence. That what does Romans 8:28 say? All things works out for the good for those that love God, for those that are according to him, who are called according to his purpose. And his purpose was, when he came here, he came that we may have life and have it to his fullest.
Amen.
Now I'm turning over to Pastor Ray.
The wages of sin is death, so he paid it. God so loved the world
He loved you and me enough to send his only begotten Son to die so that we might be saved, saved from eternal damnation, total separation for an eternity away from him, where there be nothing but weeping and crying and torment day after day after day after day, forever and forever. He prayed, he paid that sin debt, so that we might have life with him in glory, where there never be again a day of weeping, a day of crying, a day of dying, a day of sickness. Every day will be a day of joy and peace. How did you get that joy and peace? Well, Christ paid it. He said, I give it to you as a gift. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Not through going to church, not through trying to be the best person you can be, but it's through Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So if you are being moved right now through the power of the Holy Spirit, and you know that you are a sinner, your whole lifestyle is that. The Spirit of God has been telling you and me that. And you need a Savior? Jesus is saying, I am the Savior. And I'm here for you. And you invite him into your life. He said, I'll come in. And I'll stay with you forever and forever. And then when your life 10 years over, or my life 10 years over, he'll call you on home. But we'll be with Almighty God, our Lord and our Savior. And all those that have gone on before us, forever and forever. So today, for the first thing I ask, let's get our salvation part right. On Palm Sunday, they had it mixed up a little bit, but he's still King of Kings, and he's still Lord of Lords.
Yeah.
Invite him into your life, right? Say, Lord, I need you to come into my life. Come into me. Save me from my sin. Save me so that I might be a part of your church, a part of your body, a part of who you are. And when life is over down here, I have a home in heaven. If you pray that prayer, he is faithful to come in and to stay with you. Second part of my invitation is for church home. Well, yeah, many local congregations are closed, but we still have live streaming. We still can hear people accept 25%. So you still can come. But most importantly, you are the church. But you need to get involved in a local church where you can grow, where you can be and do and serve and use your gifts that God has given you. Your gifts and your talents. Some of you have some great talents that God wants you to use. You can't use it in the world and in the church at the same time. But God has given you some great gifts and talents to build up the kingdom of God. Then others of us, we need prayer. So let me pray for us. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for Palm Sunday. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for Good Friday. And there was nothing good about it except for our salvation was nailed to a cross. Thank you for Easter Sunday morning when you got up with all power in heaven and earth in your hand. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for this, that we know without a doubt, because we are trusting in you and our Redeemer live. We have a home in the heavens. And when this old life is over, we know that there's a funeral every day seems like that. Funeral homes are packed. The coronavirus has killed over 500,000. But those that love you, those that were your children, they are rejoicing. They're at home. But those that had no relationship, they are waiting for the pits of hell. So our task is to go and tell somebody, because death is real and the grave is earnest. From thus we came and thus we shall return. But to know Jesus, we have everything that we need. We may not have all the food that we want. We may not have all the money that we think we want. But we have everything that we need. Our help might not be the best, but we have everything that we need. And for that, we are grateful. And Lord, I just thank you. And as we look forward to beholding right into your face as a natural man look at a face. Oh, I believe that day that's when we'll cry and you'll wipe the tears from our eyes when we see you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is my prayer in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
God is good. Just want to remind you that next Sunday, well, this coming Friday at 1 p.m., join us on Facebook, and we'll let you know other meetings be available to you. We have the last word from the cross. We have Minister Bobby Mitchell, Minister Richard Norman, we have Deacon, several of the deacons preaching. And we have Gwen Burks, and we have our Dean Richardson. I'm sorry.
Richardson. Jackson.
You would all do it. Oscar Harris, Deacon Harris, would be one of the speakers. Dr. Zosia Mayo would be one of the speakers, and myself. So come out and join us at church at 1 p.m. or join us on Facebook. We will bring the word forward. Amen. And then on Easter Sunday morning, we will be here. We will have little things for the kids and stuff like this. But also, it will be the first time we have Sunday school since in a year. So come out at 9 a.m. for Sunday school, and then we have worship service at 10. And again, if you can't, because of health or whatever, you can't get out, you'll be able to see all of that on Facebook as well. God bless you. God keep you. We thank you for your tithes and offering. You've been paid plenty to share it with you. It's been over a year now since the church been locked down. And I am so thankful. We have some of the trustees and the ones that count the money here today. And they can tell you that God has used you and has been faithful. We have not missed a bill. All bills are paid. Only God can get that away. Amen. Because I tell you, a year ago, I said, Lord, I'm going to make the mortgage. How am I going to do this? And everything is shut down. But God is faithful. We haven't missed a meal. I've gained a little bit of weight. God is good. And we praise him every day. Amen. I thank God for you. Thank God for all of my family that's watching today and all of the church folks all around the country. Blessings. Just enjoy the rest of this day. And if the Lord said the same, we'll see you Friday. Don't forget Wednesday night Bible study on Zoom. And also, next Sunday morning, Easter Sunday, a Sunday school and a worship experience at 10 o'clock. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. And as I would say, go out and have a meal on me. But some places still can't go. And God bless you and God keep you. Amen.
Amen.